इक्विपमेंट रिलायबिलिटी एंड स्पेस क्वालिफिकेशंस। कम्युनिकेशन सैटेलाइट बिल्ट इन 1980s एंड 1990s हैव प्रोवाइडेड ऑपरेशनल लाइफ टाइम ऑफ अप टू 15 ईयर्स। वंस द सैटेलाइट इज जियोस्टेशनरी ऑर्बिट, देयर इज अ लिटिल पॉसिबिलिटी ऑफ रिपेयरिंग अ कंपोनेंट्स दैट फेल और एडिंग मोर फ्यूल फॉर स्टेशन कीपिंग। The components that make up the satellite must therefore have a very high reliability in the hostile environment of outer space, and a strategy must be devised that allows some components to fail without causing the entire communication capacity of a satellite to be lost. Two separate approaches are used: phase qualification for every part of a satellite to ensure that it has a long life expectancy in orbit, and redundancy of the most critical components to provide a continued operation when one component fails. Space qualification. Outer space at geostationary orbit distances is a harsh environment. There is a total vacuum and the sun irradiates the satellite with 1.4 kilowatt of heat and light on the each square meter of exposed surface. Where surface are in shadow, heat is lost to the infinite sink of space and the surface temperature will fall toward absolute zero. Electronic equipment cannot operate at such extreme temperatures and must be housed within the satellite and heated or cooled so that its temperature stays within the range of 0 degree to 75 degrees Celsius. This requires a thermal control system that manages heat flow throughout a GEO satellite as the sun moves around once every 24 hours. Thermal problems are equally severe for the LEO satellite that moves from sunlight to shadow every 100 minutes. The first stage is ensuring high reliability in satellite is by a selection and a screening of every component used. Past operational and test experience of components indicates which component can be expected to have a good reliability. Only components that have been shown to have a high reliability under outer space condition will be selected. Each component is then tested individually or as a subsystem to ensure that it meets its specification. This process is known as a quality control or quality assurance and is vital in building any equipment that is to be reliable. Once individual components and a subsystem have been space qualified, then the complete satellite must be tested as a system to ensure that its many systems are reliable. When a satellite is designed, three prototype models are often built and tested. The mechanical model contains all the structural and mechanical parts that will be included in the satellite and is tested to ensure that all moving parts operate correctly in a vacuum over a wide temperature range. It is also subjected to vibration and shock testing to a simulate vibration levels and G forces likely to be encountered on launch. The thermal model contains all the electronics packages and other components that must be maintained at a correct temperature. Often the thermal vacuum and the vibration test of the entire satellite will be combined in a thermal vacuum chamber for what is known in the industry as a shake or bake test. The antennas are usually included on a thermal model to check for the distortion of reflectors and displacement or bending of support structure. In orbit, an antenna may cycle in a temperature from above 100 degree to below minus 100 degree as a sun moves around a satellite. The electrical model contains all the electronic parts of a satellite and tested for correct electrical performance under the total vacuum and a wide range of temperatures. The antennas of the electrical model must provide the correct beam width, gain, polarization properties. Testing carried out on the prototype model is designed to overstress to the system and induce the failure in any weak components. Temperature cycling will be carried out to 10% beyond expected extremes. Structural loads and G-forces 50% above those expected in flight may be applied. Electrical equipment will be subjected to excess voltage and a current drain to test for a good electronic and thermal reliability. The prototype models used in this test will not be useful before. A separate flight model or several models will be built and subjected to the same test as a prototype, but without the extremes of temperature, stress, and voltage. Pre-flight testing of flight models, while exhaustive, is designed more to cause a failure of parts rather than to check that they will operate under the worst case condition. Space qualification is an expensive process and one of the factors that make a large GEO satellite expensive. Some low Earth orbit satellites have been built successfully using less expensive technique and relying on a lower performance in orbit. LEO satellite system require large numbers of satellites that are generally less expensive than the large GEO satellite. The Iridium system, for example, was designed with 66 operational satellites in a constellation to provide a continuous worldwide coverage, with at least 8 spare satellites in the orbit at any time. If one operational satellite fails, a spare is moved into take its place. This allowed Iridium satellite to be built with a higher probability of failure than a GEO satellite. Experimental satellites have also been built using a low-cost technique, and the University of Surrey, UK, for example, built a series of digital store and forward satellites that were used by radio amateurs and others, which each cost less than the $1 million. Most of the components on the survey satellites were not space qualified, but were selected carefully to ensure the best possible lifetime at reasonable cost, and then the entire satellite was subjected to shake and bake test. Many of the electronic and mechanical components that are used in satellites are known to have a limited lifetime or finite probability of failure. If failure of one of these components will jeopardize the mission or reduce the communication capacity of the satellite, a backup or a redundant unit will be provided. The design of the system must be such that when one unit fails, the backup can be automatically take over or be switched into the operation by command and from the ground. For example, the redundancy is always provided for a traveling wave tube amplifiers used in a transponder of a communication satellite, as these are known to have a limited lifetime. The success of this testing and the space qualification procedure used by NASA has been well illustrated by the lifetime achieved by the many of its scientific satellites. Satellites designed for a specific mission lasting 1 or 2 years have frequently operated successfully for up to 25 years. Sufficient reliability was designed into the satellite to guarantee the mission lifetime, such that the actual lifetime has been much greater. Reliability. How the reliability can be qualified? We need to be able to calculate the reliability of a satellite subsystem, and the launch cost will be calculated on the basis of an expected lifetime. The manufacturers of satellite must provide their customer with a prediction or guarantees of reliability of the satellite and subsystem. To do this requires the use of reliability theory. Reliability theory is a mathematical attempt to predict the future and is therefore less certain than other mathematical techniques that operate in absolute terms. The application of reliability theory has enabled satellite engineers to build a satellite that performs as expected at an acceptable consideration cost. It should be noted, however, that the cost of the satellite is very high compared to the other equipment with a comparable number of components. A large GEO satellite cost around $100 million to build, close to the cost of a Boeing 747 jet airliner. The cost is acceptable because of the high revenue earning capability of the satellite. The reliability of a component can be expressed in terms of a probability of failure after time t, PFT. For most electronic components, probability of failure is higher at a beginning of life and a burn-in period than at some latter time. As the component ages, failure becomes more likely and leading to the bathtub curve as shown in the figure. Components for satellites are selected only after the extensive testing. The aim of the testing is to determine the reliability, causes of failure, and expected lifetime. The result of this plot is similar to the figure. Testing is carried out under the rigorous conditions, representing the worst operating conditions likely to be encountered in space, and may be designed to accelerate the failure in order to shorten the testing during the needed to determine the reliability. Units that are exposed to the vacuum of a space are tested in a vacuum chamber, and components subjected to sunlight are tested under the equivalent radiant heat condition. The initial period of reduced reliability can be eliminated by a burn-in period before a component is installed in the satellite. Semiconductors and integrated circuits that are required to have a high reliability are subjected to burn-in period from 100 to 1000 hours, often at a high temperature and high excess voltage, to induce a failures in any suspect devices and to get a beyond the initial low reliability part of the bathtub curve. The reliability of the device or the subsystem is defined as RT, that is equal to NST divided by N0, that is a ratio of number of surviving components at time T to the number of components at start of test period. The numbers of components that failed in time T is N of T, where NF of T is equal to N0 minus NS of T. From the engineering viewpoint, what we need to know, the probability of any one of the N0 components failing. This is related to the mean time before failure, MTBF. Suppose we continue testing the device until all of them fail. The ith device fails after time TI, where MTBF is equal to M equal to 1 upon N0, summation I varies from 1 to N0 TI. The average failure rate lambda is a reciprocal of MTBF, M. And if we assume that the lambda is constant, then lambda equal to number of failures in a given time divided by number of surviving components. So that is lambda equal to 1 upon ns multiplied by delta nf divided by delta t, that is equal to 1 upon ns dnf divided by dt, that is equal to 1 upon mtbf. Failure rate lambda is often given as an average failure rate for 10 raised to 9 hours. The rate of failure dnf by dt is the negative of the rate of the survival dns by dt. So we can redefine the lambda as lambda equal to minus 1 upon ns dns by dt. By this definition of the reliability, R is equal to ns by n0. So, lambda can be given as minus 1 upon n0 r d by dt of n0 r, that is equal to minus 1 by r dr by t. So, as a solution, r is equal to e raised to minus lambda t. Thus, the reliability of our devices decreases exponentially with time. With zero reliability after the infinite time, that is a certain failure. However, end of useful life is usually taken to be a time t1 at which r falls to 0.37 of 1 by e, which is when t1 is equal to 1 by lambda, that is equal to small m. The probability of the device failing therefore has exponential relationship to the MTBF and is represented by a right hand end of a bathtub curve. Redundancy. The equations in the sections allow us to use or calculate a reliability of a given device when we know its MTBF. In a satellite, many devices are used, each with a different MTBF, and failure of one device may cause a catastrophic failure of a complete subsystem. If we incorporate a redundant devices, the subsystem can continue to function correctly. We can define the three different situations for which we want to compute a subsystem's reliability. Series connection used in a solar cell arrays. Parallel connection used to provide a redundancy of a high power amplifiers in satellite transponders, and a switch connection often used to provide a parallel path with multiple transponders. These are illustrated in figure and also shown in hybrid arrangement. A series and parallel connection widely used in electronic equipment. The switched connection arrangement shown in the figure is also referred to as a ring redundancy, since any type of component can be switched in for any other. Switches S1 and S2 are a little more complicated than as shown, affording the choice of multiple paths in an M for N ring redundancy configuration. The important point to note is that the active devices R1, R2 to Rn have sufficient bandwidth, power output range, etc. to be able to handle any of the channels that might be switched through them. Most DWTHs and SSPAs are such wideband large power range devices. As an example, parallel redundancy for the HPA of a 6x4 GHz bent pipe transponder is shown in the figure. The transponder translates incoming signal in a 6 GHz uplink band by a 2225 MHz and retransmit them in a 4 GHz. The high power output stage of the transponder has two parallel TWT amplifiers. One TWTA will be switched off but must be present a max load when both off and on. If one TWTA fails, the other is switched on either automatically or by command from Earth. The TWT is a thermionic device with a heated cathode and high voltage power supply. In common with other thermionic devices such as the cathode ray tubes and magnetrons, they have a relatively short MTBF. Although the MTBF may be 50,000 hours, this is a period after which 50% of such devices will have failed on average. The parallel connection of two TWTs, as shown in the figure, raises the reliability of the amplifier stage to 0.60 at MTBF period, assuming zero probability of a short circuit. A lifetime of 50,000 hours is approximately 6 years of continuous operation, which is close to the typical design lifetime of satellite. To further improve this reliability of the transponder, a second redundant transponder may be provided with a switching between the two systems. A combination of parallel and switch redundancy is used to combat failures that are catastrophic to one transponder channel and to the complete communication system. Thank you.